Books and Books in Coral Gables. Thank you all for coming down tonight. Before starting tonight's event, I'd like to ask everyone to please silence their cell phones. Also want to remind everyone we have events like this every night at Books and Books, and you can pick up a calendar of events at the counter. If you'd like more information about the many events we have here, please visit the website. And if you are not already signed up to receive our email announcements, we would love it if you did that. I'm going to be passing the clipboard around. And so if you don't already get our emails, we'd be happy to start sending them to you. And we're so eager to have folks signing up for email that at the end of this month, we're going to raffle off a gift card to the folks who have signed up for email. And just so our customers of longer standing don't feel left out, we'll also be raffling off a gift card to folks who have been receiving our emails previously. We're live streaming on the internet tonight, so folks who are watching at home, if you'd like to purchase a copy of the book and have the author sign it for you, just call into the store and we'd be happy to take care of that. One more bit of business. At the end of the presentation for the question and answer period, so the folks that are watching on the internet can hear your question, please raise your hand and a gentleman will come around with the microphone so the folks at home watching will be able to hear. Don't be shy. This evening, Books and Books is very pleased to welcome Professor Eric Furley and his new book, The Urban Master Planning Handbook. Professor Furley is the author of this book's companion volumes, The Urban Housing Handbook and The Urban Towers Handbook. He is a trained architect and urban designer with work experience in property development and several design practices in Paris and London. And since 2011, he has been an assistant professor at the University of Miami School of Architecture. This book provides comparative visual analysis of major urban extensions and master plans around the world. Each of the book's 20 subjects is rigorously analyzed through original diagrams, scale drawings, and descriptive texts, which are complemented by key statistics and color photography. And as you can see, Professor Furley has brought along a PowerPoint presentation, so this should be really interesting. Looking forward to it. Please give a very warm welcome to Professor Eric Furley.
Thank you. Thank you very much for coming. It's a special pleasure to be here because actually it's the only, you already realized that it's the third book that I'm publishing each time with a co-author, in this case, the German urban designer Katharina Grön. And it's the only place actually where I have the honor to, you know, to do my third presentation, and I did also the one for the last book and the one for the first book. And just as a little anecdote, Books and Books to a certain extent is also the reason why I live now here, because through the first presentation of the first book, I actually got to know several faculty members of the University of Miami, which afterwards asked me to apply for an open position, which I did and was accepted. So this is somehow a special place for me here. The presentation is relatively long. I hope not too long. I haven't timed it. But that's the cover of this latest book. It's, I think, the best introduction for the background of this book is maybe to say two or three words about the first two ones. Now it's presented somehow as a series. It wasn't intended at the very beginning. The planning for the first book actually started in 2005. And the second book and the third book just came, you know, somehow a bit by chance, but I think there's a certain logic of development behind them. So here are the three books. Just to say two words about the first one, which was very architecturally oriented compared to the last one. And the main idea was really to understand through 30 case studies, 30 traditional ones and then 30 contemporary ones, was to understand how an urban fabric is built up through the repetition of an architectural typology. In this case, all the examples were residential typologies. So that's the idea of this book. And And the way of presenting it, which is quite repetitive and analytical, is the same way also that you will see in the second book and in the third book. So the idea here is really to work as much as possible to scale so that we understand the difference in size between those typologies. And to show you a very comprehensive explanation of each case study. So here, these, by the way, are not pages from the book, but just material that I put together for earlier presentations. Here, just one of those typologies was actually the terrace house in London. An example here from Belgravia, which is positioned just south of Hyde Park in London. I hope that works. And you can see here the specificity of this example in fabric is actually the strong differentiation between the front of the house and the back, the interior of the block, which when it was built was simply a service road, probably quite dirty because it was used for the carriages and the horses of the people who lived there. So at the end of the day, if we're looking at the architectural plans here, they're very typical for the terrace house in general. The specificity of an example like Belgravia is that it's very much upscale. So compared to the typical terrace house, which could be compared to the brownstone also in that you can find in Manhattan and many other places, the difference is only that you have two or three stories more than for the usual one family house. And the most important one is the structure, which is positioned on the back of the plot, where formerly the carriages were, you know, parked and the service people were living on the second floor. Interesting here also in terms of section is the fact that you have the ground floor level positioned somewhere in between the street level and the garden level, and none of them are actually the natural datum. So what the developers did, they took out the ground from the back in the interior of the plot and they formed the streets on a slightly higher elevation. So the advantage of that is that you gain one level which has at least some kind of acceptable light levels. Otherwise, it would just be a basement. And here you have a certain opening in the back. So that's very typical for the terrace. And I think it's also the case for the brownstone in the US. That's somehow the analytical method that we are trying to follow. I went there to all the places, took the images myself, and was here, for example, very much interested how the connection of the former service roads was done with the main street. And we can see here through the architectural expression that this is really a very upscale example of townhouse town housing. And here the concept was to compare a traditional example with a contemporary case study. So in this case, we found this project, which has been built in Cambridge, to have very similarities with the terrace houses that you have seen in Belgravia. So you can see there's an idea of some kind of a muse typology in the center of the block, and you know the most of the structures being oriented to the outside. You can also, because it's positioned in Cambridge, what the architects explain is that they were very much interested to keep the green spirit of the campus architecture of Cambridge. So it's a mixture and a contemporary adaptation of what we have seen here previously in the center of London. So the whole book was very much organized by densities. So we can see here one example, which obviously is going to house far more people per hectare than the example that we have seen in London. So this is a very prominent one. It's the example of the extension of Barcelona at the end of the 19th century, designed by Ildefons Cerdà. And what we did here is, again, you know, show everything to scale, take one architectural item out and analyze it in more detail. Again, I would like to talk more about my last book, but I think it's important to understand how this kind of method has been, you know, repeated with different topics over several years. And here you can see, you know, the very typical sections and floor plans of those houses. Just to finish this, well, I always find it worthwhile mentioning that the interesting thing about Cerdà's plan for Barcelona is actually the fact that the urban design has almost exactly been implemented. So if you have been in this part of Barcelona, you probably recognize that, you know, you indeed have this kind of plan, which is here in this case just, you know, a part of the competition entry. But what has completely been changed is actually the architectural typology that has been implemented. So in this case, you see that Serdar thought of just having 3 to 4 story tall buildings, which would just close 2 sides of the squares, and the center was meant to remain completely green and to be open on 2 sides. In reality, and you know that, what happened is that those blocks have been closed on all sides. They are up to 7 stories tall, and in most cases, the ground floor is actually covering the whole interior of the plot. And just in some cases, and there's a program actually now by the city of Barcelona, the city is trying again to get rid of the structures in the center in order to have a little bit more green qualities in those constructions. So let's jump further. Here again, the contemporary comparison was an example from Buenos Aires, where actually the architects were trying to find a solution for the fact that those houses, those apartments are very deep. Again, it's very developer friendly. The developers just tried to utilize a maximum of the block area for the apartments themselves. And because at that time, the 19th century, it was impossible not to allow a view towards the street, you couldn't cut them into two, but you had to have very deep floor plans. So one side being oriented towards the courtyard, the other one towards the street. The consequence of that is that you need this kind of light air shafts and light shafts in the middle, otherwise the typology would not work. And the example from Barcelona is explaining how our relation to the street and the courtyard has changed, meaning that somebody who is now oriented towards the courtyard only might not necessarily pay less for his apartment simply because he's gotten rid of the traffic noise, which, you know, wasn't that such a problem in the 19th century. So here again, in all our books, the figures are very important, specifically the density figures. So what we did here, we have the different categories. We have courtyard houses, row houses, compounds, and apartment buildings. So the last example was an example of the apartment building. The first one was an example of row houses. And they are all have been ordered by theoretical habitable rooms per hectare. So you see, for example, that you know that the typical courtyard house in Beijing has a very low density, also because it just has 1 story, while the densest one would be here an example, the only high-rise example in this book, which was actually an area of the Upper East Side in Manhattan that we have chosen, and where we have calculated the theoretical density, which is going up to 2,700 habitable rooms per hectare. So that was the idea for the first book. The second one somehow was a logical extension, I would say. A friend of mine who's a developer and whose father had built one of those modernist towers in the 70s in Paris, he told me, well, most of your examples here are actually just low and mid-rise. So could you do a similar study for high-rise architecture? And I saw at the beginning, I was a little bit reluctant because high-rise architecture is usually just about, you know, the highest, the tallest building, the most technological answers, questions that we were less interested in. But afterwards, I thought, well, maybe we could have a look at high-rise from an urban perspective rather than from an architectural and technological one. And so here I worked together with a French art historian. There's also a French version of this book. And what we did, we had different parts. Here, this is again some kind of morphological, typological ABC of high-rise construction. We have categories which are single towers, then we have clusters, and we have vertical cities. So that was the way we classified all our examples. That's here a famous one that most of you probably know. It's the so-called Gherkin. Obviously, that's not the official name, but a famous building by Foster in the city of London. Typologically, you can understand, we called this example here the monument in the block. Monument because it's freestanding. Monument in the block because it's still situated in a relatively dense urban environment, or for that matter, actually a very dense urban environment, which is the city of London. And you can see here how Foster and partners have found a very interesting solution from an urban architectural point of view. From an architectural point of view, which is quite unusual, is that they have reinvented a courtyard in the tower But obviously, as a courtyard can't be in the center of the tower, they somehow put it along in a spiraling fashion along the skin of the building. So some people actually have a view towards the courtyard and not only to the exterior. That's actually quite unusual in high-rise architecture for obvious reasons. This building is, by the way, also not famous for necessarily being the most space efficient, which is somehow not surprising. Here again, very repetitive, always at the same scale, the aerial view here, and then in double size, the urban plan that we have redrawn and which explains how this building is freestanding, but with a very quite limited distance to its neighbors. And here again, we use the same comparison. We had a major example, which is explained in more detail, and then we have secondary examples, two of them, which are just explained through a diagram and some text and images. And here you can see the Seagram building by Mies van der Rohe and Philip Johnson, which is doing something slightly similar to what we have seen with the Gherkin. It means it is a very monumental building. It is a single building inserted in an existing urban structure. And Mies van der Rohe quite famously decided actually to step back from the street to create a publicly accessible square and just to go to the unlimited part of the plot and to build as tall as possible. And that's obviously, that was an invention at his time. The earlier New York buildings, they are called wedding cakes buildings because they have this kind of section. They have different step backs from the street because those were the regulations. And only a part of this was free for a development which could go as tall as possible. So interesting about the Seagram building that this kind of a strategy that Mies van der Rohe was using was afterwards copied by other architects, but because the city had adjusted the high-rise building regulations to this kind of meaning,
such a success that the city afterwards actually gave bonus development potential for developers who decided to give public access to parts of their plot. And for example, if you walk on Avenue of the Americas on the other side of the Rockefeller Center, you can see that almost all of those towers do step back from the street. It is because of those bonus incentives given by the city.
I'm losing too much time here with the older books, so I won't say much more about this project here by Jean Nouvel in Barcelona again, from an urban point of view, quite here. Again, we were talking about the different categories, so this was a lesser-known example of a high-rise district or high-rise city. So the definition was here that a majority of the buildings would be high-rise buildings or at least mid-rise buildings. And Higienopolis in Sao Paulo is quite exciting in the fact that if you see these images here, you would not expect that the name of the quarter actually was kind of a marketing strategy of end of 19th century developers who had created some kind of garden city. So they had just bought a piece of land. They have built the street infrastructures. Afterwards, they have subdivided the plots, sold them to individual owners, private individuals, together with fairly strict urban and architectural rules. So this was actually, at the end of the 19th century, beginning of the 20th century, was a very well-off one-family district. At a certain time, those houses were standing empty, for whatever complex reasons, and developers started to build up the houses, to demolish them, and to build higher and higher. So this happened incrementally, and what we see today are buildings which are going up to 40 stories and are positioned as closely together as possible. So somehow you can recognize and you can imagine that this historically had been one family housing standing one next to the other. So it's quite interesting how the development happened here. One of the interesting things, and this is somehow leading to the third book that I was meant to talk about, interesting about high-rise is the relation to the neighbors. So many examples of the first books were low-rise and mid-rise. It means like once you have defined those rules, the architect can essentially do whatever he wants without asking his neighbors, because the height of, let's say, 6-7 stories still leaves you a lot fairly easy light conditions through the use of a courtyard, so that you don't have to impede on the rights of your neighbor. Once you start to develop high-rise, those rules somehow change, right? If you build high-rise close to a mid-rise or even to low-rise, in some way you start a process of negotiation, which is, at the end of the day, is a political discussion. So what we did here, in this case, it was my co-author, Julie Jambal, the French art historian. She analyzed the high-rise seven cities around the world, and here was actually Frankfurt in Germany. So she just went through all the material, had interviews with the people, and was just trying to understand how the city came to a logic where they're actually creating clusters of high-rise, which is the case today. But historically, they decided once to actually have a ring of high-rise around the former fortifications. This didn't work. Then they wanted to do fingers. This didn't work neither. And now they're doing clusters because somehow that's the easiest solution. And so it was very interesting how the city is trying to use building regulations in order to make something positive out of the high-rise dynamic as much as possible. And so here, what we can see here, and this again is just a comparison of the density figures. Just to finish the high-rise topic, I think one of the major criticisms about high-rise is the idea of a fake density. Actually, if we do analyze many high-rise examples, specifically those which have been created in the post-war era, we actually realize that they have a very low overall density. So if we compare it, for example, with the center of Paris, which I think has a density of around 4, FAR, means like you have 4 times the size of the lot built, you know, one above the other. That's what 4 means as an FAR. So let's say that's the figure for central Paris. Then you can realize that some of the modernist high-rise developments are much lower. So we have here a French example. It's just at 1. It's just because there are so many open spaces in between those towers that actually the whole idea of density becomes completely compromised. And that's where you realize that it doesn't, in many cases, doesn't make that so much sense. And I think one of the reasons why Rockefeller Center is considered to be a very positive example is maybe also because it does have a very high density of almost 11.5. And if you see, you know, at the end of the day in Rockefeller Center, there are very little open spaces. You know, look, example, the one which has the ice ring in the winter, that's, at the end of the day, a fairly small square. It seems to be successful. So I just want to come back to those first two books, not necessarily for marketing reasons, but also just to explain where we're coming from, and that our idea was just to complement a typomorphological study, but to understand a little bit actually about the setup, in this case, of urban projects. So the question for us really was, you know, we can analyze the architecture, we can even analyze the urban design, how the streets look, how the public spaces look like, but we also have to understand how this actually has happened. You know, how did ownership play into this question, right? And how did the size of development teams play a role? Did it make a change if we actually have an architect which is separate from the urban designer, or if both roles are taken by the same entity? So these are the questions that we were interested in this book here, and we analyzed 20 examples from around the world in order to make that point clear, hopefully. Once again, as you can imagine, the problematic of these kind of books is to make the right selection, right? If you choose projects which are too different, then the comparison becomes meaningless. And if you only choose projects which are very similar, then the comparison, you know, is also senseless. So we were trying to look for projects, and that's where the title comes from, which carry the name master planning. At the end of the day, what does that mean? It means that there has been, at least in one moment in the development, a very strong control from the public side or the private side of the entity, of the totality of the whole plot in order to develop this new piece of city. So these projects essentially have in common that they have a large-scale approach. I think it's important to say this, that we don't want to leave the impression that this book is about urban development in general. Most of the examples are really master planning examples. And, you know, let's take a, you know, if we were to ask the question which have been the most interesting or most important urban projects in the Miami region in the last, I don't know, 20, 30 years, then most people would probably say it's the change of South Beach, right? And the decision to maintain the Art Deco architecture. You could say similar things, for example, about the Marais in Paris, right? So what I'm trying to say is that there are urban strategies which can be done in a very different way than the examples that we're going to see here. So these are all quite radical examples of urban transformation. So let's go further. We start with an American case study. It's one that I like pretty much because it's very simple and very complex at the same time. So the simplicity is somehow the architecture and urban design, right? It's not very difficult to understand here how this is set up. It's kind of a extreme example of what would be called a tower in park typology. And to say two words about the historic background, this project has been planned during the war, during the Second World War. It just started, I believe, in 1946, partly built also for veterans which were coming back in order to house them. However, this was not the main reason for this project to be built. One of the main responsibles was on the public side, Robert Moses, which is, you know, infamously famous also for the construction of the park and highway system in New York. So he was also at a certain point responsible for the urban renewal program. And the idea here, specifically with Stuyvesant Town, was actually to prove that urban renewal could be done from the private side in the city center. So several other projects had been done by the same developer, which, by the way, was MetLife Insurance, I think the biggest company at that time in the world. Several projects had been done in the outskirts of New York. I think Parkchester, for example, was one. But the idea was to prove that this kind of large-scale housing developments with limited rent, so it was like for the lower middle class with a rent control, that these projects could also be done in the city center and here in the Lower East Side in Manhattan. And just to say bit about the legal background, and we will realize that in many of the examples, one of the questions for the city is really how can it intervene in order to use eminent domain in order to build a new district. And what happened here in the US, in New York, was actually that a new law was created, which first of all gave the possibility to the city to actually give to a private developer a large site to the cost of expropriation for the city, which I think previously was not possible. And at the same time, also to offer to the private developer, in order to make the deal attractive for him, the opportunity actually to pay over several decades only the taxes on the base of the pre-redevelopment condition. And in that case, because the area which was called the Gas House District was actually a three-quarter slum, with many owners not even paying the taxes, this was an extremely interesting deal for MetLife Insurance, who purchased the whole plot. And just to show you, and that's the work actually of my co-author, Katharina Grund, who for all the examples has redrawn those diagrams in which you can read the development of the area over time and the change of ownership. So what you can see here, the blue actually means private ownership, and the red would be public ownership. So in this case, actually, there we couldn't have, you know, too many examples of diagrams. We thought that four would just be enough. So there should be actually a 1A in which this line here would be public, because what the city did is they bought as much as possible or expropriated the existing small-scale structure. Those were essentially tenements. For those of you who know Manhattan and New York a little bit, so these were very dense multifamily houses. And the city expropriated them, bought them, demolished them all, I think in several months, extremely quickly, and afterwards sold it to a very interesting price to MetLife Insurances. And interesting is also, just as a detail, that even all the public property here was actually given over also to MetLife Insurances. So all this area here is now open to the public, but is still private property, right? So, and I think at the beginning, it was actually closed off, and it's only now that you can just walk through and nobody's gonna scare you off. You see afterwards the master plan prescriptions and the architecture which has been implemented. I think from architectural and urban design point of view, what's quite interesting here, and I think also the case of many modernist large-scale housing developments, is actually that it's very difficult to separate the architecture from the urban design. If you imagine that you had have an urban designer and afterwards an architect, in reality actually it was the same team. It was a fairly large team which was actually working together, I think, which was led by one of the architects of the Empire State Building. And but my question was, you know, how would you imagine to separate those two rules? And this was one of the main issues that we were extremely interested in, is, you know, how can we separate the work of the urban designer from the work of the architect? And I think for many architects, it seems to be almost logical that the best solution would be if the architect can do everything, not only from a financial point of view, but also just from the quality of the result. But then again, you know, we saw some images of Barcelona, and we're going to see some images of Paris, where, you know, most people would agree that these are good examples of urban design. But these are actually examples of urban design where the role of the urban designer and the one of the architect was completely separated, right? So that's an example, and very typical for modernist developments, where this actually has not happened, right? So the architect is also the urban designer. And those diagrams here show you the use of the building. So this would be residential. You can see a little bit on brown here on the outskirts, because that's where there are some restaurants and some shops, but it's extremely minimal, probably not even 1% of the whole development area. And here you can see the green areas and the footpaths going through the whole development. This is the street network. Again, this is just in order to give access to the parkings. And here you can see the public network. So we are positioned in the Lower East Side. So compared to other projects where, you know, the public network connection is much more problematic, we have actually here the L line, which is stopping, you know, right in the corner of the development. So we don't have any major problem regarding public transport. Obviously, we have, you know, many bus lines going to different places in New York. Here just, you know, the architecture. Right, it is what it is, fairly simple. The floor plans, the same. They have certain qualities. You know, they try to have at least double orientation for each apartment. But in general, we have a relatively uninventive architecture for the floor plans. But then again, you know, at the end of the day, this is social housing. And I think everybody was trying to keep it as simple as possible. And here again, you see the context of the Lower East Side. Peter Cooper Village was just an extension done slightly later by the same developer for a slightly higher rent, but still under rent control. So here, some other images. You can see, you know, this whole development has very much a notion of being cut off from its surroundings. I mean, today the Lower East Side has become quite, you know, cool and hip. But at that time, you have to realize that most of the surroundings were considered to be slum-like. So in a way, the decision to be quite rude towards your surroundings is probably one that you might understand. It was also marketed at the end of the day as a suburb in the city, which I find also interesting. I mean, I can't imagine that today the related group would sell their developments as being suburbs in the city, right? So I think our understanding has slightly changed about these questions. Now we are jumping to Germany. What we have seen here at the end of the day was a small-scale starting position in private hands, which ended up very much in a large-scale development. And once again, this was also remaining in public, in private hand, in one single hand until today. So these are tenants living there, and these are not condos. So it's somehow, from that point of view, a fairly extreme example. If we have a look now at Vauban, which is a project which is still ongoing, I think some projects are not completely finished, but started after the German reunification in 1989. It's quite interesting, but it is very different in terms of process. Actually, the starting position was public ownership, because this was the site used for French barracks. You know that until the reunification, you had French, the Allies, the French, the British, and the Americans who had still soldiers on German ground. And after the reunification, it was decided that this wasn't necessary anymore. I think everybody was also happy, you know, to spend less money for those installations. So those French barracks came back into ownership of the federal state, if I'm not mistaken. And the city of Freiburg, which is situated in the southwestern part of Germany, realized very quickly that you know, this was situated on a beautiful, in a beautiful surroundings, very green, and in fairly close relation to the city center of Freiburg. So the city actually decided to buy the land from the federal state and to organize a master plan competition in order to transform it into a mixed use but mainly residential area. And interesting actually here is that Freiburg-Bonn became one of the most famous examples of ecological building, I would say, around the world. I mean, I've been talking to many people here from the city and architects, and they're saying that they constantly receive architectural and urban groups from all over the world. So this is a very, very famous project. And it's not that famous because of its, you can see, iconic architecture, but it's famous because of the ecological performance of what has been built. And once the master plan had been decided, and I think we have an image here of the winning master plan scheme, or is it not here? What's interesting, that's it actually, I hadn't seen it. So that's the competition result of a fairly large invited competition. And what you can see here is the built result. So without, you know, it would be good to have one next to the other, but I think you get the sense that quite a lot of things have changed. So first of all, that's very typical for master planning, but it's very rare that a winning master plan scheme is really implemented up to the last house. But an interesting point is that one of the reasons that this happened had also ecological reasons, because Freiburg-Vauban was also one of the first examples in the world where passive houses have been built. It means like houses which do not need any energy input. In the early stages when this happened, those houses had to be north-south oriented. They could not be east-west oriented. Today this has slightly changed, but at that time, the 90s, people saw that it was necessary. So interestingly, that's one of the reasons why the master plan had to be adjusted, you know, in order to respond to those developers who had the idea to implement those ecologically very performant buildings. Another point which wasn't completely clear at the time of the competition was the fact that the city of Freiburg actually decided to come back to a small-scale cadastral logic. So this one, you know, this very large piece of land in single hand actually was cut into pieces, sold by auction to people who were interested. The second most important decision of the city was to fix a price per square foot and actually to make a decision based on the program. And that's, once again, that's the reason why there was so much ecologically performant architecture, because the city, which is, by the way, also politically green, made the decision to choose the projects which came with the ecologically most interesting proposal. And in many cases, once again, that's a particularity, those were actually groups of individuals which have been teaming up in order to build a small multifamily building. So what you can see in this image here, for example, it's one of the cases, this one here, this one at least I'm sure of, that's a multifamily building, but there is no single developer of that. That's a group of individuals who have been teaming up, have been signing a contract with a bank, took a mortgage, and then afterwards took a project manager or architect directly who would, for them, create this building, each of the units being different according to the choices of the owners of the apartments. So that again, that's a very unusual development logic and one that I'm currently very interested in. Let's jump to the next example, which is again in Germany, again linked to the reunification. So the project started just after 1989. It's situated in Potsdam. Potsdam, which is actually the capital of the land, I think Brandenburg, if I'm not mistaken, but at the same time also considered to be a noble suburb of Berlin, right? I think it's just 30 kilometers off of Berlin. So some areas of Potsdam are actually somehow have a strong economic link to Berlin. And at the same time, it's also the capital of a land itself. As you know, Berlin is actually a kind of a state on its own in Germany and doesn't have any hinterland, which obviously was important when it was, before the reunification, when West Berlin was kind of an island surrounded by East Berlin. So Potsdam is part of former East Berlin, and the area of the Kirchsteigfeld, that's the name of the project, is situated in the southern part of the city, which was much less privileged than the area that I just mentioned to the north, you know, villas which are usually lived in by people who are in Berlin. That's an area which is socially more modest and had been chosen by the city and a private developer for a large-scale housing development. Interestingly, you have, in terms of organization, you have many similarities with what we have seen in the Stuyvesant town, even though the built result obviously is very different. But we have actually a small-scale ownership situation at the very beginning, even though it was a greenfield site. So these were actually fields, right? So this wasn't yet developed, but it was in private ownership. Private ownership is very relative because we are talking of a situation which is just after the reunification. So East Berlin was communist. There was no private ownership as such. So, there was a difficult time in between the reunification and when those plots had to be given back to the former owners to be afterwards bought by the city, which is, how do you call the right to buy first? Preemptive right? Or what I'm trying to explain is that the city sold the whole site to a private developer, but first had to buy the land, in order to be the owner. So we have quite a few similarities to what I had just explained for Stuyvesant town. The similarity also is that this was kind of social housing or affordable housing with limited rent control, meaning that those apartments are not condos, are essentially still in ownership of the same a developer, which is called the Grotgruppe. This example is also interesting regarding the links to the US and a movement that you might know called the New Urbanism, you know, which is also very much linked to the university where I teach, the University of Miami, and the practice of my former dean, Elizabeth Plater-Zeiberg. So the Kirchsteigfeld is actually considered to be one of the few examples that you could call European versions of New Urbanism, because the organization is quite similar to many, many examples that have been done in a similar style here in the US. And by the way, the office which has master planned the development, Krier and Kuhl, is owned by Rob Krier, who is the The brother of Leon Krier, who has built parts of the architecture school here at the University of Miami. And in terms of process, what happened is that the developer organized a charrette. It means like for several days, you had 7 or 8 invited architectural companies who worked together with the developer and the city in order to develop a master plan. And the deal was that one of those, the best master plan would be chosen, or maybe not the best, but the one that the developer preferred. And all the other architects would not completely lose, but would be invited to become architects of the architectural proposals. Right? So here you have a clear separation, and that's very typical for new urbanism, between the master planner and the architects, which then build the individual buildings. Just very similar we have seen in Freiburg-Vauban, but obviously with a very different type of urban design and architecture. Interesting also, just as another background, that's actually the final master plan. If you see the very early versions, and even the one that has won the competition, it was much more dense and more, I would say, medieval in character. I think Rob Krier actually was a little bit disappointed that he had been pushed by the developer to open those courtyards much more up than he intended to do, and somehow to lose a little bit of this very urban tension that he had in mind. And you know, if you're looking at this now, specifically at this image here, you realize that you know the character is almost one of a garden city, right? You have a very green environment, you have huge courtyards, and the courtyards are not even really courtyards because you know the perimeters have been cut through in order to allow a maximum of light. So I find it quite interesting how you know those ideas of recreating a traditional urbanism at the end of the day are quite difficult to re-implement because the traditional urbanism also creates many apartments which tend to be very dark. And that's obviously something that a contemporary developer is not necessarily interested in. And that's how you know over time the urban plan has slightly changed. And you can see here, you know, this is the initial ownership structure that I explained previously. That's somehow the ownership. So everything is going to be in one single private ownership. The streets are given over to the city, so they don't remain private. And then you also have some public amenities. In most cases, those going to be schools, which are given over to the city. But this the buildings themselves remain in private ownership, and all of them by the same developer. And here you see some of the architectural features. You can see again that most of it is residential, some of it are amenities. You see an actually quite interesting urban pattern that has been created. And what I pretty much like about this development that you can, in a very conventional way, experience it while walking through the streets. But you can actually also decide to walk mainly through the courtyards, which is a very different experience. And that's something which I think is a great quality. Just to come back to this idea of urbanism, so what happens is the master planner creates the urban plan, defines the perimeters where the architectural structures have to be aligned, and then each architect receives for his specific plot or for his district rules that he has to follow. So there is a maximum height, there's also a minimum height, there are prescriptions, for example, of how to put the parking underneath, you know, this kind of protrusion here, so that the parking is less offensive, is a little bit hidden. So all those ideas have been mainly developed by the master planner, but the architect has quite a lot of freedom in terms of architectural style. So you can see here, you know, there is not one single style. It's not specifically traditional. There are quite a few differences. This, by the way, this is a larger block which has been designed by SOM, which usually, you know, from an architectural point of view, is not famous for being, you know, specifically interested in traditional architecture. So that's the Kirchsteigfeld. Let's jump here to the third example. I think we have 4 in this presentation out of 20. It's probably one of the most famous urban developments that have ever happened, or at least one of a larger intervention which has been managed by Baron Haussmann, who was the planning director for Emperor Napoleon III. between 1853 and 1870. The project that we chose to analyze is actually one which was not part of the first priorities after 1850 or 1853. There's one major reason for that is that if initially the idea was with many of those breakthroughs, I guess that some of you know a little bit about the development story of Paris. So initially, I mean, just to say maybe two words about that, you have in the mid-19th century a city of Paris which is completely overcrowded. Large parts of it are hygienically in a very bad state. And so Napoleon III, the emperor, just decides, who was apparently very interested himself, generally interested in architecture and urban design, and has drawn some of the breakthroughs actually himself. He decided that the city had to be urgently modernized. One example, for example, being John Nash's Regent Street in London, that some of you might know, done in a very similar way. It was just a decision to create a monumental access through an existing urban fabric in London. So Baron Haussmann, under the rule of Napoleon III, did something very similar, but in a much more extreme way than you have seen this in London. I mean, London and the UK have, similar to the US, a much more liberal approach also to urban planning. And that's obviously until today not the case of France. And here it's really the city who took most of the planning responsibility, even though almost all of the developments have been, at the end of the day, built by private developers. That's important to understand. The city very rarely developed itself. It sold the plots after it had, expropriated the former structure. So once again, I was trying to explain why Avenue de l'Opéra, so that's the avenue which, today leads to Garnier's Opera House, why this wasn't of first priority. It's because the first idea to create a link between the Louvre as the center of the city and power and one of the new stations, which was Gare Saint-Lazare, the direct link, which have been something like that, wasn't possible because, several major squares were, in the middle of this link. So actually the city realized that Avenue de l'Opéra was an interesting breakthrough, but compared to Boulevard Saint-Germain or Boulevard Saint-Michel, didn't have the same strategic importance. That's the reason why the implementation of the project had to wait until Baron Haussmann has already left office, which was in 1870. And this, the reasons, just to say words about that, was also that the population realized more and more how he had hidden the real debt from the population. I think the Saint-Simonian principles of the city government and Baron Haussmann was to say, we take heavy debts because we do believe that in the long term, the tax creation will be so important that those interventions are definitely worthwhile. But short term, the creation of debt was so enormous that this created scandal, and he had to leave in 1870 his offices. I think these are the types of discussion that we have until today, and that's the question of how short and long term can you be. So here you see a plan that I have found, which actually shows the parts of the existing structure, those lots which had to be expropriated and redeveloped in order to make the breakthrough possible. Right. Again, just to say two words about the legal background. The city, actually, most of the breakthroughs which happened, and you can see here a plan of S71. So, it's difficult to read, but if you know a little bit Paris, I think you can read some of those major interventions. So, it's all those orange ones are Haussmannian interventions through Paris. And most of them, or many of them, actually existed as an idea for 50 years or 100 years. The question is only how could the city implement them to acceptable costs. And one of the things that they did at a certain time. And you, if you walk around in Paris, you might sometimes be surprised why a sidewalk is just opening up to create like a mini square, right? It seems like not to have any sense. And the reason was that the city thought, well, rather than to expropriate, you know, to spend a lot of money, couldn't we just make a rule that if somebody, if the owner of a building and a building lot is redeveloping his house, we just, you know, ask him to step further back from the city so that we create larger avenues with more light, with more air. But, you know, it was a slightly naive thinking. I think what they thought is that the developers would do that very quickly because stepping back from the city would offer them like a more interesting product. In reality, I think what happens is that one developer is looking at his neighbor and asking, you know, what is he actually doing? Shall I wait further? So all those strategies which were meant to modernize the city of Paris with a very little cost did not work out, and there had been other attempts. So I think Baron Haussmann here just realized, okay, we don't have any other choice. We just have to at least try to improve the legal conditions for expropriation. So I use the word expropriation quite often. Maybe I shouldn't, because in most cases, the idea obviously is just to build up the plots and not to expropriate the owners. It's just you need the opportunity, if one owner says no, to act, because otherwise the whole project is impossible. So what is quite important to understand is that one of the expropriation laws had been changed before Haussmann came to power, and the expropriation procedure became much less expensive for the city than it was before. And another thing that they could do, you can see here that if you look at Avenue de l'Opéra, the way it has been implemented, there are actually quite a few blocks here which have been redeveloped and which do not touch directly the street. So again, this has a legal background because the rules had been changed. And if the city had a good reason why they would expropriate further, then they could do it to the same conditions. Initially, in the year before this change, it wasn't possible. And that would mean that in many cases, the breakthroughs would become, from an urban point of view, very awkward, right? Because you would just have a piece of building cut off and an urban structure behind that, which doesn't work. So the reasons here to extend the development was really to give more urban coherence to the whole quarter. And so once again, these are actually legal considerations almost more than architectural ones. And you can see here some images of the built result. We look here from one of the perpendiculars towards Avenue de l'Opéra. So you can see here one of the new built buildings and here an older one on the side. This, through the logic that I had just explained, would probably also have been expropriated, but I guess because this is something like a town palace and it's also the headquarters of a bank, it had been decided not to tear it down, to keep it and produce this very kind of charming and awkward corner here towards the Avenue de l'Opéra. And here we can see, interesting also about, you know, not only Paris, but these kind of typologies, is their flexibility. So as you can imagine, most of those houses have been built as residential structures. But what happened over time is actually that the whole area of Avenue de l'Opéra is actually today more an office area than it is a residential area, right? You also have, by the way, this is Les Galeries Lafayette and Printemps are just situated between the behind the Opera House. Again, public transport, as you can imagine, is not exactly a problem in Paris, at least today. Here you see the street structure, and you can see, and once again, you know, I think the Parisian interventions are also famous for the tree planting. Now, Avenue de l'Opéra, because of this very monumental building, which was built at the same time, actually is an exception, and the urban designers decided that the view towards the Opera House was so impressive that actually the trees wouldn't, in this case, not be a plus value, but rather the opposite. So Avenue de l'Opéra actually has been built mainly without any large trees, unlike, you know, most of the other famous Haussmannian interventions. Talking about typologies, the topic of the first book, You can see here the work, one of the pages of a book written by an architect called César Daly, who was actually trying to document all the interventions which happened at that time to make a book out of that, which would be afterwards helpful for the work of architects which would have to work on similar plots. So it's quite interesting that if we're talking about the Haussmannian apartment building, everybody considered it to be a type. But compared, for example, to the terrace house, which is almost completely repetitive, right? I mean, they are essentially identical. The breakthrough logic of the Haussmannian interventions didn't allow a repetition of the plot's size, right? Because they were completely by chance. You were just cutting through an existing structure, and wherever, you know, the existing plot size was, you were just redeveloping a building. So you were not able actually to have a lot of control of the actual form of the plot, but you still had a logic of how to put the different interior spaces, for example, along the facade. So this is a so-called enfilade, which goes up much earlier in time, and it's not only a French way of organizing those apartment buildings. It meant that there was a row of living, dining room, and other rooms which were situated along the major facade with a long corridor behind that. So there definitely is a typology, but it's not repetitive as some others where, you know, the developers had much more freedom to build whatever they want. I guess this doesn't need much more explanation. Once again, just to situate yourself, that's Galerie Lafayette, and this is Printemps, and the Opera House here, and once again, those blocks have all been redeveloped. One reason was here to be in complete control of the facades surrounding the opera in order to raise the monumental effect of the built result. And here again, that's the comparison. That's the new Haussmann building, very typical in terms of facade design, and that's an older one. By the way, the rules concerning the facades became much more subtle over time, because very quickly after the first interventions, where actually the city even asked the developers to completely align the balconies. So, you know, the homogeneity was almost perfect, and very quickly people started to complain. The poet Baudelaire was a famous example for that, and he was, you know, starting to criticize the homogeneity, the boredom, and with time the city decided actually to leave a little bit more space. So there were still facade prescriptions, but they became a little bit more subtle and not so strict. So here again, you see that the idea was not to have trees and to allow for this, even quite far away from the Opera House, to allow for the monumental view on this building. We finish here with Broadgate, which is actually not a residential example, but an office development. It's I think it has zero residential participation. Interesting here, just to say two words about the starting conditions. As you might know, the UK and specifically London have a leasehold system. So what happened in this case is that British Rail, who was the owner of Liverpool Street Station and Broad Street Station, and owner of the whole plot, decided at a certain point that Broad Street Station could be demolished and sold, and that Liverpool Street Station had to be renovated. So they were looking for a developer who would make a bid for the whole area, renovate the station for British Rail, and redevelop it in whatever, you know, most profitable way. I think for legal reasons, the railway company was not allowed to sell a freehold. So in most cases, actually, also in the case of Belgravia, I don't know if you remember the example from the first book with those terrace houses, actually the land was in ownership of private families who would sell plots of land for a leasehold of 99 years. That was the usual time frame. And after 99 years, the land, but also the structure built of it, actually comes back in ownership of the freeholder. So here, an in-between solution was be found. My guess is that they were not allowed to sell the land, probably also because of the use for a railway station. But they also thought that they would maybe not find a developer who is interested to buy only for 99 years. So actually they made a 999 years leasehold, which at the end of the day can be considered to be a freehold, right? So that's a detail, but again, I think from a legal point of view, probably quite relevant. And Broadgate became, which is situated on the fringe of the city of London, actually not very far from the Gherkin that you have seen in the high-rise example, was at that time situated in a problematic area because it's the fringe to the borough of Hackney, which is not exactly famous for a banking district or a very posh environment, but I think one of the poorest boroughs in all of England. So the situation close to Liverpool Street Station, which might from today's point of view look very attractive, was at that time in the 70s and early 80s, was rather problematic. So the genius of here and their architects. So the developers were Stanhope, with a famous person, Stuart Lipton, who actually became, do you say knighted? Sir Stuart Lipton, mainly through this project also. So these were the developers, the architects and master plans were Group, which I think also have offices in the US, are mainly engineers, but are also doing master planning and some architectural work. So this was one of their earliest interventions here in London, where they're from. And the genius of the development was actually to not consider, you know, the city of London is here on the southern fringe, right? The north was considered to be a very bad area, by night probably even, you know, fairly dangerous. So the genius was somehow to be able to offer more than the competing developers, simply because a decision was taken not to consider this just a hinterland, but rather to create a network of public spaces and squares which would raise the value and take the property, the high property values from the south further to the north. So that's, you know, if you walk around today, it looks like very logical. But if you, you know, if you go a little bit into the historic situation, it's actually quite an interesting decision to take. Another interesting decision that the developers did was they were rebuilding or keeping some of the older parts of Liverpool Street Station, while competing developers at that time just decided to tear everything down and to make proposals similar to Euston Station, for those who know London a little bit, which is a very modernist and not overly charming development, just done slightly earlier than here Liverpool Street. So that's a little bit the background of Broadgate. There are many things to say. One of the reasons that it was also economically very successful was the decision to create very large floor plates, which was a response to a change in the financial markets. So even when this project, I think, finished in a real estate crisis, it actually leased out quite easily because the architectural offer in terms of floor plans and interior organization was quite unique for London at that time. And you know, many developers have actually copied this kind of architecture. Even the offer that the tenants had was much more interesting for the tenants than would have been in earlier developments in the city of London. So and here again, you can see the, you know, mainly office use. You see the railway station, which is still in use. Interesting also the fact that the developers find an affordable way to build above the tracks without the station having to be shut, right? So the Liverpool Street Station started to continue working during all the construction process, while most of the project is actually built above tracks. And you can see here the pedestrian network that I was just mentioning going essentially through the whole area, trying to give value through an hinterland which previously was considered to be of no use. Here again, from an architectural point of view, that's probably one of the nicest developments. The project started with Arup, as I explained, and the master plan was done by Arup, but afterwards, actually, the work was given over to SOM. So SOM did this building here and also the one which are situated on the eastern side along Bishopsgate. And here, again, you know, talking about the design district or talking about many new office developments today to use public art as some kind of a sales argument is something which is completely normal. I mean, you couldn't imagine. I mean, in many cities actually even ask the developers to spend a certain percentage of their investment in public art. Again, Broadgate was, in Europe at least, one of the first developments to do this in a quite extreme case. So I think I forgot this artist. This is obviously Sarah here, but there are quite a few pieces which are, you know, make a Broadgate an interesting environment. Just to come back to legal questions, the land itself has not been given over to the public, but still remains private, but it's completely publicly accessible. So according to English law, or British law, I guess, what they have to do, they have to close it at least once a year and not allow access from the public in order to keep it in private ownership. And that happens on Christmas Day. So that's just a little anecdote, which I think doesn't have a huge impact on the project itself. Interesting, again, you know, this dates from the beginning of the 80s, mid of the 80s. So, you know, it's in redevelopment. Actually, this tower is still part of Broadgate, has been built just some years later. It's again, I think, SOM. And there are already plans actually to redevelop the whole development with a higher elevation. And the reason for that is that the City of London has slightly changed the view corridors in the city. So previously, actually, the developer was not allowed to build higher up. And now, because of those changes, they can and they will, which obviously some people criticize because the coherence of the whole development will probably not be improved through the fact that some of those buildings are going to be taller than the others, which is not the case. Let me just finish to show you some of the annex of the book. And you can see here a table with all the 20 projects. They have been organized by size. I think that's very interesting, quite unusual to do. And we, you know, our way of comparing projects is not the age of them, because we realize the way to organize projects is not, you can't read this in chronological order, but rather the logic here was to organize them by size, because the way you organize a project and the type of control that you can have on a project very much depends on how big they are. So the smallest example is actually Broadgate, the one that we just discussed. The largest one would be La Défense Saint-Arche, which is situated in the suburbs of Paris. And it's famous for its high-rise architecture, but the development area itself is much larger than just the high-rise part. You have the Beijing CBD, and you know, you have 20 different projects, and here you can see we start in the beginning of the 19th century. And at least half of the projects are very recent or not even yet finished. What we did here, and you can't read that here, but it's actually a comparison of the major density figures, just to have an understanding how much actually has been built up here, how many people live there, and you know, this kind of information, which is quite key. Here what we did is just, you know, to come back to the question of urban form, what's actually the built result, right? So how do the urban fabrics compare according to different decisions taken regarding the development process? So here, you know, you have the Paris case, you have Amsterdam, you have London, Rotterdam, Stuyvesant Town. This is London case again. This is Ural-Lille master plan by Kohlhaas. This is Montpellier master plan by Bofill, who is famous for his quite hardcore neo-modernist architecture. Here you have Battery Park City. It's another US-American example. You have a part of La Défense in Paris. You have Potsdamer Platz, Hammarby in Stockholm, which is still in construction. Again, very famous for its ecological features. You have the Kirchsteigfeld that we discussed, Vauban that we discussed. You have Massena Nord. It's one of the new development areas in Paris along the new National Library, which is not that new anymore. Puerto Madero, it's the only South American example here from Buenos Aires. Also still in construction. You have the Beijing CBD, still in construction. You have Marunouchi in Tokyo. That's quite interesting. It's an area which is rather changing over time. So quite unusual, actually, in the context of this book, because the ownership hasn't changed for a very long time. And it's rather a question of how can you accommodate new architectural typologies in an existing urban fabric. This is a part of downtown Dubai, which is the area situated about the Burj Khalifa, you know, the largest tower in the world. And that's another American example. That's False Creek North in Vancouver, which again is famous for its high-rise architecture and a quite interesting typology of situating like a three, four-story tall townhouses in a perimeter block with a tower being situated on the border or in the center. So actually that's a typology which it resembles quite some examples that you can find here in Miami, only that we are less timid about showing the parking in the base. Then here they're trying actually to really hide the parking in the center of the block rather than to show it openly. And here, again, that's an information that's actually quite difficult to find. I can't tell you what's the scale of these representations, but what I know is that they all have the same scale, right? So it gives you a very quick understanding of, you know, how big is actually Broadgate compared to Puerto Madero, right? How big is downtown Dubai compared to Marunouchi? And we have, just to see the US-American examples, we have here Stuyvesant Town, a relatively small size, and Battery Park City here, just next to it, which is actually an infill, as you might know, of the construction of the World Trade Center. Right, it's a consequence of the infill. So that's it. I hope it won't be long. Thank you very much for your patience.
So I noticed in all three of your books, you have different co-authors. I guess, what was something that stood out in those co-authors and when you were looking for someone to work with in each project, and what were their strengths? And especially particularly in this book, how was your co-author helped you come up with these ideas? And
well, the great advantage here, so the co-author is Katharina Grön, who works now in an urban design practice in Hamburg. That's also where she studied. She herself is born in former East Germany, I've forgotten where, in a smaller place. The advantage was that she was the same person who had done the architectural and urban drawings for the first book. And that's why, because we got to know, we worked together in an office in London. She was doing an internship, so she was working for me at that time, and I liked her work. And that's how we remained in contact, and we decided that it would be to say a little bit more about her background, she is not an architect, but she's a planner, right? So in Germany, actually, I don't think you can do that here in the US. I'm not sure. Can you have full-length planning studies?
They have masters.
You have a master, but in Germany, it's a bit different. You can actually only study a planning for 4 or 5 years. I think it's actually 5 years. So she did that in Hamburg. So her background was really important. We had many discussions because obviously, I mean, I'm a trained architect. I tend now to be more interested actually in urban questions, but still, you know, I'm very much product oriented, which a planner is not. And so this was a good way to work together. The other book, the high-rise book, once again, the main co-author was Julie Jambal, who is an art historian, just finishing her PhD at the Sorbonne about the history of high-rise in Paris, and that's actually a funny anecdote because I was in the is a new architecture center in Paris, doing research in the library, which is part of this new complex. And she saw me with meters of books about high rise sitting in the library, and I think that made her nervous because she's writing, you know, herself in this domain. So she was talking to me, and then, you know, we started to get to know each other, and I realized that she was the perfect person to work with, again, because she had a different point of view than I had. You know, she was, you know, art historian is really quite far away from architecture. So I always try to work together with people who can bring me something which I don't have. Compliment. And because you asked the question, so just to finish, I don't want to forget Caroline Groen, who is a German, in this case, architect, who did the research for all the contemporary case studies of the first book. So I was focusing and traveling to all those 30 traditional made two world tours, and I don't know how many other trips. And she was mainly working, she did also some trips to some of those contemporary case studies, but she was mainly working with magazines in the library, with the internet, in order to find examples which were really brand new, partly even still in construction. So one example would, for example, you might know BIG, you know, the Danish architects, who are going to build those two towers in Coconut Grove, and who were part of the competition for the, Bjørke Ingels. For the convention center, exactly. And they became famous. Actually, one of their first projects was this kind of courtyard development, which is built on a slope in, I think, in the suburbs of Copenhagen. And we were quite proud that she found this, you know, at a very early stage. So when the book came out, it was really brand new, which was in 2009. So most of these examples are still absolutely valid, you know, and very contemporary.
I could just say this out loud. In looking at all these typologies, did you see something interesting in terms of comparing projects where there was an architect that was the lead versus an urban designer?
Well, I mean, it's always difficult to say because at a certain point, you know, an architect who is doing many urban projects becomes a planner, so or an urban designer at least, right? So even if I take the examples of DPZ here from Miami, you know, who are now mainly famous for their master planning, being one of the founders of New Urbanism, I do believe that they started as architects, and I'm not even sure if they did even a master. Elizabeth Barter-Zeiberg and Andres Duany in urban design, maybe they did, but I believe, you know, with time they did so many of those urban projects that they became specialists in the field. And so from that point of view, it's a bit difficult to make the differentiation, but I like your question because I think it's a central question for an architect to know what kind of work he can do or what he can't do, right? So an architect who believes that it's the same thing to just design a building or to design a whole district, I think can very quickly get into problematics, and maybe also at a certain point realize that the work that he's doing, that he is now forced to do, is not the work that he's interested in. I think that's also, I've been working on both sides, and it's quite different. I mean, at the end of the day, as an architect, you are considered to create a product, right, over a relatively short time span. I think the problematic of the urban design work is that usually you can work over several years on almost the same master plan, you know, which is just changing slightly. So the interest of the urban design work is at the end of the day, the fact that you are in contact with so many different parties and that you're trying to negotiate all those interests. So it's a very different type of work, and I think it's important to know what you are interested in as a student or as a young professional. I don't know if that answers your question. Thank you very much.
Well, that was one of the more informative architecture presentations we've had here for a while. Very interesting. The book is for sale at the counter over there, and Professor Farley is going to be signing over there at the table to the left of the screen. And please, that was great. Let's give him another hand. Thanks very much. All right.